Okay, so today I'm presenting for the chapter 3. So I guess from this session onwards, then I just try to stick to the book down as provided by the club instead of trying something new, like what I've done the previous weeks. So
you put Quardo in his, you know, in the back burner.
Yeah.
But let me tell you, you know, there's more adoption, you know, with Quarto lately. Okay, especially there's more adoption for using Quarto, okay, because you know, you can also blend, you know, different languages there, like Python, and I think that another one is observable that I was in a webinar and they were using it. So let's stick with the book then, because you know Jonathan was having a heart attack.
Yeah, that's true. And it's also easier to compile everything. And I mean, I use Quarto all because in my work, I also use Python a bit. So it's a bit more seamless. And I also like the callout boxes, you know, that is provided in Quarto.
Right.
It looks nicer. And there's no like big changes has to be done on top of the R Markdown. So I thought, why not? But then, yeah, we should not because of the book club issue.
Yeah, John said, please, you know, stick with the book down, you know. we'll talk about Quarto, you know, a couple of years, you know, from now.
Yeah, I guess.
All right.
All right. So today I'm going to present a few things. So I'm not going to go through everything. So in this chapter 3, we talk about in the chapter, it was discussed about this transformation and adjustment, the fact that there are four different transformation and adjustment. And then finally, we're going to go through decomposing time series data into the patterns that we discussed in chapter 2. And then, so we will go discuss the STL decomposition a bit in the section 3, and then afterwards we're going to discuss on the calculation of moving average, which sort of give us a bit of a an intro toward the decomposition by calculating the trend over time, and we'll discuss a bit on the classical decomposition methods and why it doesn't work really well. And then I'll just go through a bit on the methods used by the statistical agencies. I don't think I'm going through this a lot. And then last but not least, we'll go through what the STL decomposition actually entails. So in the transformation and adjustment, so there are just briefly in the chapter, the book described four adjustments of the calendar. And so the calendar adjustment is apparently, it's not like what I thought it was. I thought it's something to do about seasonality and holiday, but then apparently a far more important thing is the fact that throughout months, there are an equal amount of trading days. And because of that, then if we sum, for example, a certain value, and throughout the months there are unequal number of trading days, then of course we'll get different sum. And of course we can just take an average so that it will not be affected by the number of trading days. But then I think it's a reminder that if you want to look at daily data and we want to aggregate into a monthly or weekly or something like that, then we have to remember the number of days that we have available in our data. I think that's the main message that I can think of. And then there's also population to adjust for the number of people and so on, and adjusting for inflation, which I think is very commonly used by reporters and so on when describing changes in our economic situation. And I think they provide a quite nice example on, well, I'll just go through the book again because I don't have any new example about the Australian print media industry, in which if we are looking only at an adjusted value, then we may conclude that the decrease in turnover happens only after 2010. But then if we're looking at the inflation adjusted value, then while we can maybe the decrease starts to begin a slow around 1990, or at least we wouldn't conclude that there is an increase from 1980 onwards, like what we see in the unadjusted value. And then about the mathematical transformation, then the book describes a about a log transformation of log and power transformation. And what is intuitive or straightforward? So log Am I kicked out?
Something happened. Yeah. I think you were you were off for a couple of seconds.
Okay, that is weird. Okay. So I'll share again. So where was I? Is it about the log transformation?
Yeah, that's the last thing I've heard, log transformations,
Okay. So far, do you have anything to share about what you all read on this section of the chapter?
Just one comment. There's an interesting interactive chart. I have it in the online book
about this one.
Australian gas production, that it gives you the ability to change the lambda argument on the box transformation, and you can see, depending on where you slide it, if you slide it up or down, that you can see differences in the shape, right?
Mm-hmm.
In the shape of the plot for the time series. And it's interesting that I was checking also the examples, the exercises, and there's one question about that. Okay, so maybe if we have time, maybe we can discuss it, because one of the justification, let's put it this way, the justification for doing these transformations is to get those seasonality patterns, get them more, let's put it this way, like get them more uniform, right? Throughout time.
All right.
So sometimes you have to experiment with different transformations to see which ones are the ones that really gives you that, that goal, that meets that goal. And one of the questions is precisely in the third one, the third size, is about that. I don't know if that's Australian, because it says Canadian gas here, but it says, why this transformation is not that helpful. And maybe you can see it in the Australian quarterly gas production, that you see that even though which any lambda that you use in that plot, you see that there's always a jump in one of the, you know, in one of the periods, there's always like a big jump there. And maybe that transformation is not the most, you know, useful to get those seasonal patterns uniform, okay? You can see it in another example with the, there's another example with the, let me see here. I don't think it's in the book, but it's in the presentations, okay? The slides that comes with the, with the book.
Mm-hmm.
There is one, let me see if I can find, there is one that really achieves what they're talking about. Okay, let me,
I'll have the sharing. Charts.
Yeah. Okay, it's the one that talks about food. Yeah, Australian retail, food retailing time series, okay? In that one, in the presentation slides, it gives a lot of examples, you know, of square root transformation, log transformation, etc. And when they use the Box-Cox transformation, using the Guerrero formula to get the most optimal lambda, when they use that number, then you get a very smooth pattern on the seasonal. Okay. So that's something that I don't see in that quarterly gas production. Okay. Supposedly the best lambda here is 0.1. So if you go to that slider and check 0.1, you see that there's a big jump. Okay. In the measurements around between 1985, because it's in the middle, 1985 quarter one and 87, okay? So probably, you know, depending on what is the nature of your time series, probably the box transformation won't be the best. Maybe it will be a log transformation or a square root transformation or even a cube root transformation that they're also talking about in the slides. Okay, but that was kind of, you know, kind of interesting because we usually, especially when we're talking about tabular data, we usually do transformations to get a more normal, right? A more normal curve, right? You know, when we have this very skewed features, okay, that you use a box transformation or a Geo-Johnson transformation or even a log transformation to get more normal. Here, the objective is to get not the normality, but get the seasonality, more uniform. It says, according to the book, it says that, you know, it's better for the forecasting model. I never done it, you know, in practical, okay? And I never done it for a transformation like that, but now that I see it, maybe it's something that, you know, it should be taken into account.
Yeah, so I think, well, it looks like this box transformation is useful to reveal like a shape that is hidden. But then I wonder like how often or how common would it be used, because, well, it's not really straightforward how we can back transform this box transform values into the original scale, right? Well, of course, right. It is it's not like a black box formula, it's clear, but then I wonder, well, if you're communicating what you have to lay people or let's say executives, yes. I don't know anything, but I can imagine it would be very difficult to convey like what they're actually seeing here. And yeah, I mean, like when you mentioned that is a big jump in the data,
right?
If I don't know anything, I would say, is this an artifact made by the transformation or what? I mean, I think I'm not that clear on how we can actually use this box cost transform values.
Yes.
What do you think, Ricardo?
Yeah, precisely. You know, talking about transformation, there's a school that says, you know, hey, don't transform anything. are just distorting the data, you are creating new data, whatever. And there's another school that says, you know, hey, you know, transformations are useful because some models make some assumptions and, you know how the story goes, right? But but you are, you know, I concur with you that there's some challenges when you introduce these mathematical formulas that, for example, sometimes it's hard to explain. For example, how do you explain a Boxcar transformation? Okay, what is your justification? Maybe you can explain the square root or a log, which is just a basic formula that you study in maybe in your high school. But box transformation takes a little bit more imagination, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Of course, you have to also know your audience. If your audience is technical people, okay, econometrics, you know, PhDs or even masters, then you can talk about box transformation lab because, you know, they already have gone through that. And the other thing is that, like you said, the challenge of transforming, but then, you know, reversing that formula, okay? Some of those packages, they give you that, okay? For example, he mentions that the Fable package, it gives you the reverse transformation. So that's useful, but not all packages does it. They give you the transformation tools, but don't give you the reverse. The reverse is up to you, okay? So also you have to have that in mind. And I have encountered those circumstances. I say, oh, well, it looks very good. It predicts very well, but, you know, it's a mess, you know, turning it back. So I cannot go that way. good points there. Okay.
All right. Then we'll proceed. All right. And yeah, so in the next section, so it's discussing about the time series components. So again, recall in the second chapter that we discussed three patterns of time series data that include a transitional and cyclic pattern. And time series data can contain all three patterns simultaneously. But then of course, the contribution of each pattern can vary according to the time series that we're looking at. And so here we have, so YT, it's just the observed data. And S is the seasonality, the trend cycle, and R is the remainder. And relationship between these three components can be additive, so just summing up all the components, or multiplicative, so multiplying all the components. And note, so if you're actually taking, so if you're log transforming the data and do additive decomposition, then it's actually equivalent to using the multiplicative decomposition. So that's something to keep in mind. And so in the package, in the book, we go through the SDL composition a bit. And I'm actually quite surprised on how many time series functions are actually already available in base R. So this SDL is, so I think it's a wrapper for an exactly same function in base R in the stats base module. So I think it's quite interesting to see actually, well, that there are a lot of time series related functions already available in the base R, but that I digress. So in the SDL decomposition, so in this example, we are looking at the number of employment in US retail from the year of 1990 onwards. And here we are decomposing the employment data into, so on the top, so we are, this is the observed data, and we decompose this to trend, season, year, and remainder. And if you notice, so in the season year, so we can see that the pattern change a bit. And in the later section, we will discuss what we can do if, for example, we want to fix the season year throughout the time series, or and also various utilities of the decomposed values that we'll see later. But I think this is a quite straightforward to do using this function. And I find it quite nice actually how using such a basic function can already reveal a lot. Though I'm not entirely sure, okay, like we are decomposing the observed data into trend and season year. And then how do we actually use this remainder? So how can we, because, well, to me, it looks like, well, a very big jumble of noise here and there, but I would say it's something like there is this big variation that cannot be explained by the STL decomposition, but what exactly can we look for? I mean, are there any significant patterns or common hallmark pattern remainder component that would actually be useful? If you know what I mean, like, because to me, I can't really decrypt the pattern of the remainder, or should we look into it when will this remainder value can be useful to look at? I think that's, that's my question.
I have a comment on that. That's okay. So, I think one answer is if you were to try to, you know, you think there's other features aside from time series, these time series features that are useful, like you could try to see if you can explain the remainder with those other features. But the main thing I was thinking is, so for instance, I think it's a useful in anomaly detection. There's actually this package called Anomalize that uses STL decomposition. And then I think does some pretty straightforward, so if you assume that that remainder is like normally distributed and kind of a random variable, you can be like, well, you know, observation in that kind of remainder is, let's say, two standard deviations from the mean or something. It's an anomaly, you know. So you can use it in that way for anomaly detection. And that library, actually, I've used it a bunch, and it does a really good job at anomaly detection. So I think that's one answer. And then I think also, like, I think it can be useful for diagnostics. Like, let's say in this case, maybe it does do a good job of decomposing the time series, but let's say there is something that looks like that's not noise, right? That looks like some kind of real pattern, then, you know, I think it's useful for trying to adjust like your modeling technique. You know, like let's say maybe the variance grows over time, so it's like you should be using kind of a multiplicative model or something like that, and you can kind of pick that up in the remainder most likely if you're using an additive model. So like you would probably see that mm-hmm. remainder component, if this was a multiplicative kind of like the variation is growing over time, I would think that remainder component, you would see kind of that like the variance of that noise growing from left to right. You know? So just a couple thoughts.
Well, thank you. That's really useful because, well, at least I don't think in the chapter the utility of the remainder component is discussed. So I think it's a quite nice reminder that the remainder component can be like a useful feature for for subsequent analysis. So thank you, Kevin.
Sure. And one other thought about that is that, like, I think I think it's useful in any case for something where you're trying to do some kind of post-processing or modeling after this, where you, where it assumes that you don't have any sort of autocorrelation or correlation between observations, you know? So here you've essentially removed that. And then you can do something that, you know, requires independence of observations, for instance. But I think one example of that is a kind of looking at outliers by calculating a standard deviation and looking to see, you know, which observations are too outside of that or whatever you want to do. So yeah, that's my last thought. Sorry.
Well, I didn't mind if you want to keep it coming. So let's thank you. So that's very, very useful. Thank you again. So in the result of the SPL decomposition, so it returns various value in addition to what we already see in the above plot. So the observed, the transition year, and the remainder component. We can also see seasonally adjusted value. So I think in the later section, we will discuss where seasonally adjusted value can be useful. So in this example, then we can already see how doing this seasonality adjustment can reveal the pattern in the data. And then moving onward, I think the ordering of this book is a bit odd to me because it goes into the STL composition without telling a lot about STL composition. And then I think we'll discuss a bit on moving averages, which I think serves as like a on the STL composition. Of course, STL composition do the smoothing using a completely different method, but I think this serves as a good start on how we can actually remove noisiness or remove haphazard patterns in the data into something smooth. Okay, so in the moving average smoothing. So the motivation is because, well, time series data can be full of fluctuations, and we can do moving average smoothing to, well, as implies, smooth the time series patterns. And to do this, so we can take the average values, let's say we have a time X, a time point X, and we want to take average values of two observations before, so X. From x to x minus 2, and also to observation after a certain time point, so x plus 2, and that means it includes 5 values. So the 2x before, 2x after, and the x itself. Therefore, we can call this a moving average of order 5, and we can call this a 5MA. And the So when we do this order, so when we determine the order of the moving average, we can take an odd number or we can take an even number. So if we take an odd number, then of course the average is symmetric around the value that we are taking the average of, because we include the same number of observation before and after the time point. But we will see later, we couple two even moving average, and we will actually get a symmetric moving average anyway. So in this example, we're seeing a 5 moving average of a percent of GDP in total Australian exports. And what I think is important to notice is that the moving average cannot handle the edges of the data. So as you can see, we can only see the moving average trend line. So there is some part missing in the early and final edges of the data. And that is because, of course, if you are taking the first, let's say if you're taking a 5 moving average, then the first 2 observation, we cannot take the average of because the first, well, there is no preceding observation. And for the final one, there is no subsequent observation available. So this is, of course, this is useful, but unfortunately, if we do this, then we will lose, we cannot calculate how the pattern would actually look like in the around the edges of the data. All right, and what I find very interesting is this observation that if we couple even order of the moving average, so let's say for example we take 2 × 4 MA, so it means we do the 4 moving average first, and then the 2 moving average, and exit we will actually accidentally perform a weighted moving average, which I think is a very nice because as you can notice, so the observation, so the first observation preceding and after this time t is weighted by a quarter, whereas observation at t minus 2 or t plus 2, which is further apart from this time t compared to the t minus 1, actually weighted with 1/8. So it means that observations that are far apart actually have less influence in the for the time t. So I think it's a really nice a point that they are showing here. And of course, to me, it actually makes a lot of sense that we don't want to want to have observations that are actually far apart to have a same leverage on the data compared to the observations that are close in time. So I think that's what I can take from this section. Do you have anything to add? Oh, there's something in the chat. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think with this weighting, they also mentioned that in the context of seasonal variation, like if you have in this case, I think it's like quarterly seasonality, they're saying the first and last terms are the same quarter in consecutive years. So those will be both down weighted. I'm still trying to wrap my head around like how that removes the seasonality. But like, I think intuitively it makes sense, but I'm just trying to figure out how to like verbally, explain it. So I guess like if for instance there was like a spike in whatever it is traffic every 4 weeks or something, then you would have like all the other points around it after that first observation until the last one, it would be a quarter weighted, and then each of those spikes would be an eighth, so it kind of like downweights it so it looks like the other observations, I guess, is like one way to think about it, but I don't know, I'm still trying to think through exactly how that would work, but
So you're saying if we take moving averages and we somehow can adjust for seasonality? Is that what you said?
In this. Okay. Yeah, in this case, in the 2x4 example for quarterly data.
But only for quarterly data though.
In this 2x4, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because it says the values of T will have little or no seasonal variation remaining. There's an interaction. So like depending on what seasonality you have, you can use a different 2x8, 2x12, et cetera, to like eliminate the seasonal variation using a moving average like this. But it's not coming to me that easily. I need to like, I don't know. I think I need to see data and like see how it transforms it, you know? I might need to do that in R and just like see what it looks like. It's hard to think about without data. Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Just adding something, on the discussion of moving average. There is a forecast method. Okay, it's called ETS, based on exponential smoothing. Okay, exponential smoothing. And one of the things that the ETS tries to do is called auto ETS. Okay, is that it tries to adjust the argument of the moving average to see which is the one that gives you the most minimal error, in your predictions. Okay, so depending on that argument of the exponential smoothing, okay, which is kind of a moving average, but it's an exponential, base. Depending on that argument, you can adjust it like the lambda that we had in the Boscov transformations. You can adjust it to see which is the model that then minimizes, your prediction errors. So I guess in this topic of moving average, you have to kind of, like Kevin says, you have to kind of see it, visualize it, and also experiment with it. Okay, maybe try 3 moving average or 5 or even 7, depending on the nature of your data. And then try to get that weighted number, try to see, which is the best combination. Okay. Thank God, we have computers to do that for us. So, it shouldn't be that hard, to visualize, like a loop, getting those errors, new predictions with different parameters. Something like ARIMA, or ARIMA tries to do too. Okay.
Okay. Well, more things to study, right? So thank you. So the next section is on classical decomposition. So in the book, will discuss in an extensive manner why it is no longer recommended. But nevertheless, this method forms the starting point for other time series decomposition methods. So to do this classical decomposition, so we have to first calculate the moving average to obtain the trend cycle component. And after we get the trend cycle component, then we subtract this component from the observed data, and then we get the detrended data. And to obtain seasonal component, we just take average detrended values for that season throughout the years that we have in the time series data. And finally, now that we have the trend and seasonal component, we can obtain tracking both time cycle and seasonality from the observed time series. And as you notice, the first thing that has to be done by this method is to calculate moving average. Then of course, we cannot get a decomposed value for the edges of the data, which is the weakness of the moving average. So then there are, well, I don't look so much into the methods used by statistical agencies because so they said that the method work well with quarterly and monthly data. So I think, put off by this. Okay, so well, good to know. So I guess quarterly and monthly data, I'll look at this, but for now, we'll just go to the STL decomposition. Yes, so this STL decomposition is an acronym for seasonal and trend decomposition using LOS. And this method holds several advantages, which includes, so first, it can handle any type of seasonality. So we'll see later that we can actually tune how much seasonality we want to let it vary throughout the years. And then, which is the second point that we can, so the seasonal component can change over time with adjustable rate of change. So in the classical decomposition, the seasonal component is just the average, the trended values for that season. It will remain constant throughout the years because we are just taking a naive average. So that is another weakness of the classical decomposition. And then the trend cycle smoothness can be controlled using by determining the window. And it is robust to outlier. But then there it also comes with its own disadvantages, which include, so it does not handle trading day or calendar variation automatically. Well, so it means we can do some tricks to some extent. And then it only facilitates additive decompositions. But then of course, if we log transform the data, then we'll get multiplicative decompositions. So for this STL decomposition, we have two main parameters to tune. So first the trend cycle window and then the seasonal window. So this is just like the window, the order of the moving average, so to speak. And then other than this, then we can also see another parameter called robust into true or false, so just a logical argument. So we have seen an example of STL decomposition in the earlier section of the chapter. And then here, well, I'm showing how the pattern would look like if you're fixing the seasonality over the years. So sort of like what the classical decomposition do and how it would like if we set the STL to robust. So here we can see a comparison between the STL with default parameters and STL with robust set to true and fixed seasonal pattern. So first, if we look at the seasonal pattern, here we can see that now the seasonal pattern throughout the years looks exactly the same because this is what we have set it to do. And then compared to the STL with default parameters, then we can see that the pattern fluctuates or the height of the lines actually decrease over time. And then it comes with differences in the trend cycle component that in this default STL setting, we are actually see a smoother trend cycle component. And what strikes me the most is actually not the difference between the trend or season year, but it's in the remainder, because compared to what I'm seeing here, now the remainder looks a bit more tight or tidy compared to here, especially this component, it looks very haphazard, whereas here it looks very tidy. So I guess it's like another point in decision making that things are not as straightforward as it seems, because now it looks everything looks very different, even with a subtle difference in the argument that we set. So yeah, I think the biggest lesson here is that even though STL decomposition is as simple to do and very useful, but then it's not as simple as I thought, I guess. So yeah. Do you have any further thing to share, Ricardo?
No, we're good. We're good.
I just had a question. I remember that the bars on the side have a meaning. It's like it has something to do with the scale, but I forget exactly what it was. I was trying to look it up, but. Do you remember what those bars are?
Is it like in a map? So the height is actually represented sort of the same distance, but then the scale is very big and here is very small, I think to ease comparison across the panels.
Yeah, you're right. So it's like the first. There's like a range on the first plot in the y-axis of like maybe 3,000. And then in the last plot in the remainder, it's like 200.
Yeah,
that makes sense, yeah. All right, thanks. I forgot what that was. Yeah, I also interpreted like his use of that, the discussion of those statistical agency methods. It's really useful probably for his work. So I think he just added it. I think this is the kind of data and the kind of methods in the field that he works in, Rob Hyndman. So.
I think he do a lot of consulting for the government, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably why he included it. I can't really think of a place where you would use one of those particular variations of like ARIMA or something with when you're not in that field. But
All right. So yeah, that's it for me for today. So what should be the plan for next week? Should we discuss the exercises as usual? And if yes, then do you have like any preference on which exercise to do? Well, it seems like Ricardo, maybe question number three, even though it's in the earlier section, it seems useful, or maybe like something to
at least I can say that the experience on doing those exercises in chapter two were really valuable in terms of trying to apply the theory to the practice.
Yeah.
And remember that we had an error. At least I had an error in one of the time series because it had a null values. And in the decomposition, you throw an error, but it doesn't tell you that it's a null value. It tells you something else.
Yeah.
Then you have to figure it out. So sometimes the exercises are very useful, not only for applying the theory, but also for the errors that you encounter. Mm. Then it gives you more insight of what a function, is trying, can be applied to or not.
I remember that the error would never point you towards missing values. Yeah, I remember
I had to go to the time series and see what I did was, you know, check a time series that it was, you know, it doesn't have any null values versus the one that was working. Mm-hmm. I think it was the pig, production, whatever, the pig slaughter production. And then I found out that this one is working because it doesn't have any null values. The other one is not because it has. So I had to do some manipulation. So there's no hint in the book about that. You have to, you know, do the practice and, you know, do your exploration and, you know, try to figure out what's going on. So who knows, maybe this exercise will find something like that. Okay. Yeah. At least you already have a good hint on how to deal with it.
I have to run. Thank you so much for the presentation. For exercises for next week, I could talk about a couple that seem interesting to me. There's a couple on boxcock transformations that I haven't had a lot of experience with that, so I think that would be useful. And then the last question does some stuff with STL, and I would like to have some practice with STL. So. Those are the two that stand out to me, or the three that stand out to me. But...
All right.
But sorry, I have to drop. There's a new new toddler activity around me. So.
Okay. All right.
I'll talk to you guys later. Thanks again.
Okay.
Okay.
Bye, Kevin.
Bye.
Okay, so at least we have, I think it was 3 and 10, right?
Yes, that's true.
3 and 10. If we want to do a couple of more, you know, I won't cry.
I guess I'll have to read through the questions and then we can discuss later in the Slack channel which one we are going to do, right? Because maybe like now that I see question number 5, it also seems nice actually to tinker on our own, like finding the best boxcock transformation to stabilize the variance. Because if we do it on our own, we may think that this may look good, but if others also chime in, then maybe others also have a different opinion.
You get a different perspective, and then you find something that you didn't account for, etc. Yeah, I think it's good.
I guess. See you all next week.
Okay, so are you going to post the exercises that we're going to be working
on? Yes, I will.
Okay.
Yeah, I will.
So we'll do the next week, we'll do the exercises. Then the other week, we'll start with chapter 4, which is on my turf.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Okay.
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 All right.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Ricardo.
Have a great day, at least the rest of the day.
You too. Bye.
Bye.